Bill, pre-budget consultations wrapped up early February. The federal government is yet to set a date for budget 2023. The CD Howe Institute recently released a shadow budget. Canadians are facing a possible economic downturn, high cost of living, housing affordability still very much top of mind. What should be the focus of budget 2023 as you see it?
The focus of the budget that we're likely to see from the federal government will probably be a good deal more short-term and oriented towards the short-term news cycle than would really be desirable at this point. I think that what we would like to see, certainly what the CD Howe Institute tried to do in its shadow budget, is have more of a long-term focus, get away from some of the pandemic-driven stuff, which, however necessary at the time, all the transfer payments and so on carried on too long, and also this kind of idea that money was free and resources had no cost. So what we're trying to do with the shadow budget is we talked about it being the morning after the binge, and get more of an orientation toward the longer term. What I'm afraid we're going to see in the federal budget itself is what we've seen a little bit in last year's budget and some of the communication since the fall update, a little bit of commentary, words thrown in about the importance of long-term growth, productivity growth, rising living standards over the long haul. And then when you get into the bits and pieces of the budget, I'm afraid they're going to lose that focus. There are a lot of things that needed doing even before the pandemic. There are certainly some things that need doing post-pandemic, especially by way of reining in spending and borrowing. I hope we'll see that. I'm not super optimistic.
Let's talk about the reining spending and borrowing. Are balanced budgets a thing of the past? Do we care about balanced budgets?
Well, I think many people do. We care about them when we are thinking about our personal lives. People who are in business or in not-for-profit organizations pay close attention to the bottom line. And although economists have mixed feelings about what the right indicator of fiscal sustainability is, I think balancing the budget is a key discipline. There's nothing like watching that zero or ideally some black on the bottom line to force decisions about, you want to spend a dollar here. Well, is it worth more than the dollar that you might have otherwise spent somewhere else, or the dollar that you have to raise in revenue? If you don't have that bottom line constraint, and we've seen this spectacularly since 2015 and during the pandemic, then the discussions that the finance minister has, the discussions around the cabinet table, the discussions in the PMO, they're just not the same. They're not constrained. And lately, this has been a government that's shown a tendency to throw billions of dollars around without that kind of consideration. So my own preference very strongly is for getting to a budget surplus, an actual, the end to the red ink. And in our shadow budget, we show that's possible. The mix of things we've chosen to do it won't be universally popular. And certainly the actual budget isn't likely to show that particular mix of initiatives, but it can be done. And in the long run, I think we really need that.
Let's, before we dive into that shadow budget and what should go into the federal budget, Alberta recently releasing its budget, proposing a balanced budget law. Curious to get your take on that and whether or not this is the right time, given that we have to, there's this notion that we have to keep up with our neighbors to the south, especially when it comes to the green energy transition conversation.
Well, thank you for mentioning the United States. They're in la-la land when it comes to fiscal policy. And I think that in their case, they have the reserve currency. Borrowing from the Fed is a little different from borrowing from other central banks. And I don't think the constraints that loom for them are really registering in Congress or in the White House right now. But I'll just say one word about that. If you look at the projections from the Congressional Budget Office, it is a very short amount of time before defense spending and entitlement spending alone will absorb all of their tax revenues. They're on an unsustainable course, and sooner or later they're going to realize that and they're going to have to switch course. One of the consequences when they do is that a lot of this money that's getting splashed around for energy-related projects is going to prove not to be reliable over the long run. And when we think about what's happening here in Canada, there's a bit of a sense that money is free. A lot of businesses seem to be making their plans around it. They're certainly lobbying the government to match what the US is doing. We have to watch out that we don't end up with a lot of stranded assets. So it's an uncomfortable environment to be operating in. It's tough for a Canadian government to talk about fiscal discipline when the US is so clearly unmoored. But we do see some of those balanced budgets. You asked about balanced budget legislation. I hate to be the two-handed economist. I kind of like the idea. I've just said why I like balanced budgets. The trouble with the legislation is that when it becomes really, really hard-edged, often what happens is you start to see funny things being done with the numbers. One of the things the federal government has done recently is they've moved their a lot of their pension costs below the line. So the headline deficit that they're advertising isn't actually the real deficit. So I always worry when I think about balanced budget legislation that it's an invitation to play games. Stick with the numbers. Once in a while, you'll run a deficit, especially if the economy gets soft. At other times, you run a surplus. Let that happen. As soon as you try and lock it in, then you're going to have things happening that the Auditor General is going to say, wait.
You had used the word borrow off the top of this conversation. Let's bring it back here to Canada and the cost of servicing the debt. What does that look like now?
Well, it's an interesting area for people who watch budgets closely because things have changed in some important ways. The last time Canada got into debt trouble back in the 1990s, you could look at the federal government's debt outlays, just the interest on the debt on the expense side. And you could compare that to things like GDP and government revenue and get a pretty good sense of whether the government was in trouble or not. And of course, at the time it was. Lately, a couple of things have happened. The pension accounting has gotten more complicated, and I've just recently mentioned a problem that I see. Some of the cost of servicing those obligations is now not in the headline figures. The other thing that's happened is that both sides of the federal government's balance sheet have changed. Lately, what they get in investment income is very important also, and varying because the Bank of Canada bought all this debt at very low interest rates, and now they've taken some losses, and there's going to be a lot less investment income. So this is an area where I think the federal government could usefully clean up the numbers. And since I've talked about cleaning up the numbers, I would love to see them clean up the presentation more generally. When you look at some of the provincial budgets, they're so businesslike. The key numbers are right up front. Federal budgets were like that once upon a time. Now they are just so full of fluff and spin, and the really important numbers don't appear until an annex hundreds of pages in. There's something about the messaging right there that tells you that they might not be that serious. And I think it'd be nice, and we tried to do that in our shadow budget, put the key numbers up front, provide more informative numbers about the cost of servicing the debt with both of the income and the expense side shown. Treat people a bit more like adults and treat the whole thing a bit less like a, you know, a social media spinning exercise.
Let's talk about those energy transition numbers, specifically the net zero targets. Are we on target?
No, the short answer is we're not. The federal government has released an emissions reduction plan. They call it a plan, but it isn't a plan. It's a set of targets for a whole lot of sectors of the economy. It's an astonishing kind of exercise, really, for the federal government to have decided to extend this kind of regulatory reach into every aspect of the economy. And a lot of it doesn't seem that realistic. Here at the CD House, we've spent quite a bit of time looking at the home heating side of it, for example, what's really involved if you get rid of natural gas, looking at motor vehicles. Are we really going to be able to move the fleet of cars and trucks over to electricity? So there's a lot of hand-waving going on there. There's a lot of assumptions that we're going to be able to subsidize and regulate our way through this. One of the things in the shadow budget, and this is an area where I think people who look at it just say, are you guys nuts? We've said, we've got carbon pricing. There are things that you can do just using pricing that are very powerful and also can raise some revenue that we can use to replace some more damaging taxes. Let's do that. Let's not get into this morass that we seem to be increasingly, up to our hips or worse in this mess of regulations where we've decided that in addition to pricing carbon, we're going to have all of this regulatory stuff. We're getting kind of the worst of both worlds. There are more straightforward ways to do it. Politically, it might be a little awkward. But again, this is one of these areas where I think people need to hear a straighter story than what they're getting.
We know that the government has set out some ambitious immigration numbers. Will this help to to ease Canada's labor shortage issues? Are all the steps in place for that? Will we be seeing any kind of tax credits?
I don't know that the budget will say very much about it. They'll probably advertise the higher numbers. They will probably also say something about the expediting people with skills that are in demand. In general, I think, though, that when you step back and look at the productivity story and the need for some steps that would increase investment and growth rates over time, it's a little troubling that we're bringing in so many people when it's not only that we're having trouble figuring out how to house the new people that are coming in. We've got a bit of a pressure on the housing market, as everybody knows, other services, particularly in healthcare. But also, when you've got very low business investment rates, and Canada really stands out in a bad way when you compare us to the United States and other developed countries, bringing in all these people when the investment rates are low sort of suggests that we're planning to turn ourselves into a very labor-intensive economy. That's not the route to high incomes and sustainable prosperity. So I'm all in favor of a robust immigration program, but let's make sure that once people arrive here, they've actually got the tools they need to earn high incomes and generate that prosperity that we're going to need in the coming years.
Lastly, let's just talk about some of the existing benefits and perhaps some new ones. You had mentioned old age security and housing, of course, the Canada housing benefit. What else do you think the government will focus on, and what would you like to see the government bring in?
Well, when it comes to some of the measures that would make life a little easier for individuals, one of the areas, it's not the only one, but it really stands out in my mind, is retirement saving and income. There are a lot of pressures on people, especially because of inflation that's now cut the purchasing power of the nest eggs that people had set aside. And I'd like to see the government do quite a bit when it comes to letting people save longer, lower mandatory withdrawals in RIFs, for example. I think there are things they could do there that would provide a lot of relief for people, and it doesn't have a whole lot of fiscal cost. When it comes to restraining spending more generally, the first place they need to look is right in their own backyard. The federal government notoriously has been paying a lot of consulting money. They've also been hiring new public servants at an amazing rate. Their costs of operations have gone way up. Where's the benefit from that? We know that they're not really providing services all that effectively in a number of key frontline areas. So I think that they need to spend a lot less and a lot smarter in that area. And that would create fiscal room for many things, including balancing the budget, if they just got their own spending more under control.